What if I told you that most of the advice you've heard about salt and sourdough is missing the point? Of course, we know salt is a fundamental ingredient in any good bread recipe. But if you've spent any time on baking forums or watching videos, you'll know it's also a source of endless confusion. Most beginner bakers at one point or another have probably heard these common myths: that salt will kill your yeast, that it can destroy the delicate balance of your starter, or that you absolutely must wait for a while before adding it. But here's the secret. One of salt's most overlooked jobs in sourdough has nothing to do with any of that. Too many home bakers are missing out on the fact that salt is one of the most powerful ways to control the flavor of your sourdough bread, especially if you want to make it more or less acidic. So if you want to finally understand how to make your bread more tangy or even less sour, stick around. We're about to turn this simple ingredient into your new secret weapon. Hey, Seraphin here. Welcome back to the channel. Salt is a crucial ingredient in bread dough for several reasons. It strengthens the gluten network, enhances the flavor, and it controls fermentation by slowing down the yeast, which prevents the dough from fermenting too quickly, leaving more sugars available for a richer, more deeply colored crust. All around, so far, so good. And all of this is perfectly true for baking with baker's yeast. When the conversation turns to salt and sourdough, that's where the misunderstandings begin. Many bakers simply take their understanding of how salt affects baker's yeast and superimpose it onto sourdough, assuming that the logic is identical. Some resources even copy the explanation word for word, stating that salt slows down the yeast in sourdough and that's the end of the story. But what if I told you that salt's influence on sourdough is a lot more nuanced than that, and that you have compelling science-based reasons to use salt in your levain, or even your starter, especially if you want to fine-tune the acidity of your bread? Today, we'll see why salt is more than just a brake on fermentation. It's a powerful lever that can influence your sourdough's flavor in a substantial way. And before we dive into the science, we need to look at the history of this practice and dispel a popular source of confusion. While adding salt to a sourdough starter isn't exactly common, several traditional methods call for exactly that. The German Monheim salt-sour process, which dates back at least 50 years, involves making a sourdough pre-ferment with 2% salt. Typically used for rye bread, this method is supposed to create a milder flavor. Similarly, a traditional Italian sourdough method is said to call for adding salt to the starter at every feeding. And here is a 1970s patent for sourdough French bread, where salt is a key ingredient in the liquid sourdough starter. It's also important to remember that historically, before the widespread use of commercial yeast, many bakeries simply used a piece of dough from the previous day's batch to leaven the next one. If that dough contained salt, they were effectively using a salted sourdough starter. These examples stand in stark contrast to the widespread modern myth that the salt in our dough can kill all the yeast or harm our sourdough starters. You'll often see recipes that take great care to prevent salt from directly touching the starter or yeast, and many home bakers live in fear of salt stopping fermentation in its tracks. Now, while it's true that extremely high concentrations of salt can be lethal to microorganisms, the amount we use in bread dough is nowhere near that level. In fact, there's even a technique for commercial yeast called salt stressing, where yeast is fermented in a 7% salt solution to make it more resilient in high sugar doughs. So the salt in a typical recipe certainly isn't enough to kill the microorganisms in our dough. And this prevalent myth has led to lots of confusing advice, most notably the idea that you should absolutely delay the addition of salt. What's more, this practice has somehow become conflated with the autolyse technique. As a brief introduction, the autolyse method was invented by a French professor named Raymond Calvel, and it simply calls for mixing flour and water together before letting it rest. I have a video on the autolyse method, so I won't go too deeply into it here, but in short, the autolyse method was most likely meant to solve a common problem in Calvel's time, which was lipid oxidation. Lipid oxidation is a process that can create unsavory flavors due to certain reactions that require oxygen. Calvel's idea was to use the autolyse to strengthen the dough, reducing the need for long mixing times and therefore minimizing oxygen incorporation. The autolyse method doesn't typically call for adding salt to the flour or water, and in conjunction with the misunderstanding that salt can kill the yeast or sourdough, this mixture of ideas seems to have created a bit of a confusing situation, where some people say you delay the addition of salt to prevent it from harming the sourdough, while others think it has something to do with the autolyse process. So, to make it clear, we first need to state that salt definitely doesn't kill all the yeast in the sourdough. And in the autolyse method, given that the original goal was to reduce lipid oxidation, the reason salt is omitted is probably simply because it's not necessary. A real scientific reason a baker might want to delay salt addition is to control a process called proteolysis. Proteolysis is the natural breakdown of gluten by enzymes. By withholding salt at the beginning of a mix, you're giving these enzymes a head start that'll soften the gluten just a little. This can make the dough more extensible and develop richer flavors. Adding salt to the dough effectively puts the brakes on this proteolysis process and tightens everything back up. So in this case, delaying salt isn't really about saving the yeast. It's a deliberate choice to manage dough consistency. So we've busted the myths and clarified a real reason for delaying salt. Now let's get into the core science of what salt is actually doing in our sourdough bread doughs and levains. First, how it affects structure, and second, how it acts as a flavor lever. While salt is crucial to most bread, it is especially vital to sourdough. The acids produced by the sourdough's bacteria can influence a lot more than just taste. By lowering the pH, sourdough acids give the gluten proteins a positive charge. Much like magnets of the same pole repelling each other, this charge forces the gluten strands apart. While this adds extensibility, it can weaken the dough if left unchecked, resulting in a very sticky mess. Salt steps in to manage this effect. It shields the electrical charges, calming the repulsive forces. But it also delivers a 1-2 punch for gluten strength. Beyond just managing the acids, salt's ions form direct ionic bonds with the gluten proteins themselves, helping to create a tighter, more robust, and organized network. This is the key to getting a fluffy loaf of bread that doesn't collapse in the oven. So salt is structurally vital. But its second, and perhaps more fascinating role, is as a flavor lever. To understand that, we need to take a look inside the sourdough's ecosystem. At its core, a sourdough starter is a bustling ecosystem. And inside our starters, there is a dynamic balance between two key groups of microorganisms: yeasts, which primarily produce carbon dioxide for leavening, and lactic acid bacteria, which produce the characteristic sour-tasting acids. A typical starter is dominated by lactic acid bacteria, which can outnumber yeast by a ratio of up to 100-1. But when we add salt, things dramatically change. One study found that adding salt completely flipped this ratio. The balance of lactic acid bacteria to yeast plummeted from 20-1 all the way down to 1-1, and it could sometimes get even lower. In other words, the yeast went from being a tiny minority to an equal partner in the fermentation, at least. The key reason for this is the difference in tolerance to salinity. As the concentration of salt increases, it begins to inhibit microbial growth. It slows everybody down. However, it affects the lactic acid bacteria far more dramatically than the yeast. While high salt levels do have a negative effect on yeast activity, yeasts are generally much more tolerant to the osmotic stress exerted by the salt. And when yeast cells are stressed by high salt levels, they can adapt by producing a substance called glycerol to protect themselves. Think of this glycerol as a superpower ingredient that they carry into the final dough. It acts like a lubricant for the gas bubbles and increases the stability of the bubble walls, helping to prevent the dough from collapsing. This can create a lighter, airier crumb and give you a significant boost in oven spring. So, what does this shift in microbial balance mean for your bread's flavor? Well, the biggest change is in the acidity. Fewer lactic acid bacteria means less acid production and therefore a milder, less sour bread. At the levels of salt we add to our bread dough, around 2%, this definitely happens. So every time you make your dough, whether knowingly or not, you've quickly shifted the microbial balance. This is what makes salt such a powerful tool for making sourdough. Practically speaking, if you want to reduce the sourness of your sourdough bread, then consider adding a bit of salt to your levain, like in the German Monheim method, which calls for 2% salt, baker's percentage. This way you can easily lower the acidity of your bread, giving it a much milder flavor. Okay, you might think, so we can use salt to lower the sourness of our sourdough bread. What if I don't want to do that? What if I want to make the bread more sour? Should we just skip adding salt or delay the salt addition for longer? Well, actually, you might still want to add salt, just less of it. You see, while large amounts of salt are inhibitory, low levels of salt up to approximately 0.7% of the total levain or starter can paradoxically stimulate the growth of those acid-producing bacteria. So a tiny pinch of salt in your levain, or potentially your starter, could give you that extra bit of sourness you prefer. In studies, this is shown by the way that the overall acidity of a sourdough, measured as total titratable acidity, is minimized at high salt concentrations. And conversely, the slight stimulation of lactic acid bacteria growth at low salt levels corresponds with a slight increase in both lactic and acetic acid, yielding a tangier result. But the relationship between salt and acidity doesn't happen in a vacuum. It can also be heavily influenced by other factors like other ingredients and temperature. This is where we can connect our understanding of salt to another highly popular topic, cold fermentation. You might have noticed that many bakers online find that cold fermented sourdough bread tastes more acidic. This is interesting because many lactic acid bacteria actually prefer warmer temperatures for peak acid production. So, as I explained in my video on cold fermentation, the reason many bakers think that cold fermentation makes the bread more acidic is mainly because it extends the overall fermentation time. And now, salt introduces a fascinating new variable. It turns out that colder temperatures may actually help these acid-producing bacteria tolerate more salt. Research suggests that the optimal salt level for lactic acid bacteria growth may increase as the temperature decreases, with one study finding that 1.6% salt to be optimal at a cool 15 degrees Celsius. So when you cold ferment your dough, you could be giving your lactic acid bacteria a better chance at growing and producing acid, even with salt present. Okay, to sum it up, Since lactic acid bacteria are the primary producers of acid, salt's influence on their population directly translates to control over the sourdough's sourness. And other factors, like ingredients or temperature, can influence that. Of course, it's important to remember that every starter is unique. In one large study that looked at 500 sourdough starters from home bakers around the world, they found a pretty wide range of microorganisms. So the sourdough starter you have on hand could react in a pretty different way to salt. Additionally, although we did say that yeast are generally more tolerant of salt than lactic acid bacteria, within the lactic acid bacteria, there is a range of salt tolerance. Different strains of bacteria exhibit vastly different levels of salt tolerance. For instance, Fructolactobacillus sanfranciscensis, a common heterofermentative species in sourdough, is inhibited by 4% salt. In contrast, more robust species like the Lactobacillus plantarum can tolerate concentrations as high as 6%. This means that in a high salt environment, salt tolerant species like L. plantarum are likely to outcompete others and dominate the sourdough's microflora. This means that the effect of salt is likely a lot broader than what we just discussed, because while we call these lactic acid bacteria by the lactic acid that they produce, they are also capable of producing many metabolites that influence the flavor and quality of your bread. Different strains and species could produce very different results. So this is definitely something that you might have to experiment with a bit before finding what you ultimately prefer in terms of flavor. As an interesting final note, there's also a Japanese study that essentially made a spontaneous sourdough starter with a 5% salt solution. Their research showed that prototype bread made with a flour culture fermented in saline had a specific volume that increased from 2.25 to nearly 3.5 centimeter cubic per gram compared to controls. That's a massive difference in how light and airy the final loaf is, and it's directly linked to the way salt-tolerant microbes condition the dough. What makes this study particularly interesting is its comparison to miso fermentation, which also uses salt to guide microbial growth. This isn't just for bread either. The Japanese noodle technique, inani wa udon, called for making a dough with a 5% saline solution and leaving it overnight. This is said to allow salt-tolerant yeast to grow in the flour, making it softer and allowing it to expand better. So salt, as you can see, is a powerful ingredient that's probably pretty underutilized in sourdough baking. Naturally, I'm not telling you to start dumping salt into your mature starter, but I do hope this inspires you to experiment. Imagine creating a saltier levang for a milder sourdough shokupang, or using just a tiny pinch of salt to boost the tang in a rustic artisan loaf. So go ahead and turn this simple ingredient into your new secret weapon. Thanks for watching and happy baking!